This Lunch and Learn this month is talking about investing in your health and eating a colorful diet. So you may or may not have heard those terms before. We used to always promote eating towards the food guide pyramid food. Well, it used to be a pyramid, now it's the My Plate. But we have, through, I would say, the last 2 years, kind of switched to this colorful diet kind of thought process to get people thinking about what they're eating each and every day related to the food group. So I gave you some goodies coming in. The pink contact card is just for our office. We have a listserv started, so we pump out any kind of education we have going on. It also gives us an idea of how many extension programs you have attended other than these Lunch and Learns. The kind of goldenrod sheet is an evaluation for today. Just gives me a starting point of what kind of things you're thinking about related to your health and well-being, and then things that we're going to talk about today, and what you're willing to maybe carry on after listening to today's presentation. And then the kind of bright yellow one is the prescription for health and well-being. So there's lots of different things on there, not only related to health, but also related to financial and physical activity. Just because as we move forward in the world of health, we're talking not only about just your physical health, so we're preventing some of those chronic diseases and we're getting you to eat healthier. We're also talking about financial health, social health, emotional health, so all of those different parts of wellness that make you overall a healthier and more well person. So I'm Sarah Siegel, I'm from UW Extension. I'm the family living educator. We're located on the first floor here in the courthouse. And just to get us started today is we're gonna kind of start at the basics. So when we talk about eating a colorful diet, we just need to remember that there's a lot of terms that kind of come out when we talk about healthy eating that we just kind of want to sort through. And there's lots of studies that happen and we get kind of caught up in them. Oh, I should be eating this food, I should cut this out, or if I eat this, this is gonna happen. So just kind of sorting through some of the mumbo jumbo that we sometimes have related to nutrition. So just at the beginning, food is where your body gets nutrients. So I always tell people it's the gas for your body. So it's like gas in a car. You can't do anything without it. Nutrition is how your body uses that food. So if you choose to eat pizza and potato chips every day, your body's gonna do it the best it can to deal with pizza and potato chips. If you choose to eat a really colorful diet, lots of fruits and vegetables, your body's gonna be able to do a little bit more with those things because they contain more nutrients. And then your diet is really just your intake of foods. It has nothing to do with going on a diet or changing going on the grapefruit juice diet or all those other weird ones that we have out there. It's just basically your intake of foods. But that word sometimes is a little bit striking to people, like, oh, you're gonna make me go on a diet. You're gonna only make me eat salads. So it's really just what you're intaking for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Okay, I gave you a color card. I'm gonna give you one really quick. If you wanna look at the color, and then if really quickly, in your head, think of something that was in your diet, hopefully within the last day or two, that was that color. So the color you had, did anybody eat that color in the last 2 days? Perfect. What color did you have?
Yellow.
Yellow, what did you eat?
Banana.
Banana. Anybody else?
Tomato. Oh.
Tomato. Red, okay.
Yeah. Salad.
Salad. So green.
Potato.
Yep. Yeah, so I threw brown out there. So it's the basic colors of the rainbow. So red, orange, yellow, green, blue, purple. But then we threw brown in there just because a lot of your whole grains are brown. That's what the color we associate with them, and some of our protein products. So we did kind of veer from, I guess, the normal rainbow and put them in there. So you can see, so you're a good group because you are eating so far colorful, okay? But are there some colors that are gonna be a little bit harder to eat on a daily basis and then for sure during the week? So how did you eat yesterday? This is the Choose My Plate for the five different groups that we are gonna talk about today. So was half of your plates fruits and vegetables? So just thinking in your head the last day or two of what you've eaten, just because we're only at lunch today, is was half of your plates fruits and vegetables, and were half of your grain choices whole grain choices? And I didn't put protein and dairy up there, but we also have some little tips related to those groups too. So we're trying to break apart the Choose My Plate and talk about each individual group today But then we're also trying to relate it all together about making it colorful as a whole and what that means for you and your diet. So everything we eat and drink matters. So everything you put in your mouth. So some of you who have smartphones maybe are using or could use a food app. So there's MyFitnessPal is a good one that some people are using. There's the Super Tracker, which actually is available on the Choose My Plate website. But basically this slide is just pointing out that every single group on here is important, but they're also important together. So they're important individually, like yes, you need fruits and vegetables, grains, protein, and dairy all by themselves because they do lots of things. But the other thing is that all the interactions and the combinations that we go through when they're together. So everything that I put in my mouth is important. So in the sense of vegetables, we know that, that's not the button that I wanted. In the sense of vegetables, we know that most people are lacking vegetables. So today, how can we consume more of those? So put out by the dietary guidelines and Choose My Plate is we have this word variety, which relates to the color conversation today. So we want you to be eating different foods and beverages across all the food groups and subgroups in certain recommended amounts, okay? And we want you to stay within a certain calorie limit and certain dairy dietary components as well. But overall, my goal for today is just to get you thinking about how colorful you're eating each and every day and how can you up that color amount if it's kind of lacking in some areas. And also to be thinking about what you put in your mouth. So just like anything, if you keep a food log, you're going to be more conscious of what you're eating. If you actually plan your meals out, have them written down, you're going to be able to see your color pattern a little bit better. If you're doing it all in your head and you're scrambling last minute, those things get harder. So it's harder to, if you're going to the grocery store every day or scrambling every day about what you're going to eat, it's harder to know if you're getting all of your colors. So variety is important again because we want to make sure that you're getting every single color in every single food group because those combinations or those interactions that they have together. And we also have things that turn up in foods like added sugars we'll talk about today, sodium content, trans fats. The more planning and variety you have, the less possibly those are going to be in your diet. So we can kind of eliminate some of those added sugars, eliminate those trans fats, and also eliminate some of those high sodium content foods. So a little bit later on, we're going to talk about the nutrients that you hear a lot about. So you'll hear people say, oh, I have to cut back on carbohydrates, or I need protein, I need fat, I need certain vitamins and minerals. All those turn up in these foods, and so again, the more colorful you eat, the more likely you are to hit all of those six essential nutrients that you need. So the first group we're going to talk about today is fruits, and it's kind of dark, but on the right-hand side it just talks about you can eat fruits that are fresh, frozen, canned, dried, and then 100% fruit juice. In the fruit group, it's important to eat. We don't want people to get hung up on that they can only eat fresh fruit, that seems to be the best and the only option. That's not true. Fresh fruit, we can sometimes promote a little bit more because we want you to eat the whole fruit, so like a banana or an orange or an apple, all in its, as a whole fruit. But frozen and canned are just as good as well. And fruits and vegetables are the two groups that people are lacking. So to be honest with you, if you're eating fresh, frozen, canned, or dried, it's great because you're getting that. And also if you have picky eaters in your house, old or young, so we tend to think picky eaters are only young kids, they're older adults too. Okay, so what can you eat from this food group or what is your family willing to eat? What can you put in your diet each and every day? Dry tends to be a good snack for people to go to. If you're not good with the fruit group, I tell people to drink juice, okay? So to have a glass of cranberry juice every morning, because that cranberry juice, remember, is going to be full of calcium and some other vitamins and minerals you need that will help in other ways. So again, the fruit group is just making sure you're hitting all of them, getting your fruits as much as you can during the day and in any of these forms. What you need to be careful of with the canned is that you read the ingredients. The first ingredients should not be high fructose corn syrup, or it shouldn't say like canned and heavy syrup. We want to stay away from those. We want to gear towards more of the fruit juice ones or the canned in water. And also just as extension, we can help you with canning your own fruits come summertime if necessary. Okay, so looking at this picture, it's full of fruit, it's got some colors in it, but what do we need to be careful of?
Calories.
Calories is one.
Sugar.
Sugar. So sometimes when we talk about eating nutritious and getting fruits, is people will always throw out salads and parfaits and things like that, thinking they're healthy. And you hit on them, is we have to be careful looking at this photo, is that fruit naturally has sugar in it. It's a natural ingredient in a fruit product, which is the sugar we want. We need to be careful with those added sugars. So when you add yogurt to things, okay, that's possibly going to be adding more sugar depending on what type of yogurt you're buying, which would change the added sugar amount to your product. The other thing is we're assuming that it's granola in there, but what type of granola? Because you can buy granola that's really high in sugar because it's coated in that brown sugar loveliness that makes it taste so good. So be careful with what you're adding. So this is an example of a fruit product that most people will look at and think, that looks pretty healthy. But there are parts of it that we need to watch out for as well. So I would never tell you to not eat a parfait, just to make sure that when you're adding into it, how much are you adding? And each individual layer, what does that layer look like? So just being careful about that. The next group is the vegetable group, which this is the first group where we have subgroups. So just really quickly, do you know what the top two vegetables are that most people will eat?
Peas and corn.
Peas and corn. It's not peas and corn.
Carrots.
Potato is one.
Probably beans.
Not beans. I thought it would be corn too. It's actually tomatoes. Okay.
Fruit.
So, tomatoes a fruit vegetable. That's another topic for another day. So, what we've done is with this new My Plate, and as we're talking about eating more colorfuls, we've come up with these subgroups to try to help people out because we know that they're willing to eat potatoes. They'll eat carrots, and they'll eat corn and tomatoes. But we got some of these other vegetables in these subgroups that we really struggle with. So the dark leafy greens we know are high in lots of different vitamins and minerals. Calcium is one of them for sure. The red and the orange, they're full of different vitamins and minerals. And then we have this group, beans and peas, which some people, beans can also fit into the protein group, which you'll see later on. But we put them in two areas just because sometimes when people are making vegetable dishes, they're adding beans to them, or we're encouraging them to add beans to them. So that's a subgroup. And then we have starchy, which is where all those vegetables that everybody's willing to eat kind of sit. So the potatoes, the carrots, and the corn tend to be down there a little bit more. So again, I'm not discouraging you from ever eating potatoes or tomatoes again, just because those are the high ones, but just trying to get some of these other groups as well, because they contain so many vitamins and minerals that you need for your body to function normally. So just to kind of give you some hints is that vitamin K is really strong in dark green leafy vegetables. Red and orange tend to have vitamin A, which is good for eye health. And then our beans and peas also are going to be full of fiber and your B vitamins. So they contain lots of different vitamins and minerals within them. So that's why when we stick to only certain vegetables, we miss out on all the other ones. And this, again, is the group that most Americans are lacking in. So most people struggle to eat vegetables. And I think here in Wisconsin, just what we see through extension is come summertime, people really up their fruit intake because it's cheaper in our grocery stores. You can buy it fresh at the farmers markets, but we still struggle with vegetables. And if you are a family like mine, where you grew up, where you always had a meat and a potato, but then sometimes you had an extra vegetable on top of that, not remembering that potato is a vegetable and I didn't need both of them. So it's kind of a Midwestern Wisconsin thing. So these are subgroups and how much you need each and every day. So we have women down here, you need about 1.5 cups of dark leafy greens, but then 4 cups of red and orange, 4 cups of starchy. So even though starchy is one we tend to get, it's still a pretty high amount. And then men as well, 1.5 cups of the red and orange, and then the starchy. So it's a pretty high amount. So one of the handouts that I have for you, that if you want to pick it up, is how to know what a portion size is. And it's all related to your hand, because who has time to measure out your food each and every day? Most people don't do that. So just looking at my hand, a cupful of this or a palm of this is how much. So it'll help you a little bit more with portion sizes. And again, this is a subgroup where we're lacking. So I would say if you just up your content, you're gonna set a goal towards the end of the lunch and learn here today, is if you just up your vegetable intake or just think more about colors, that's a perfect starting point. Just because, again, we often really lack in the vegetable subgroup. And I can pick on myself because I'm here. I definitely lack in vegetable and colorful vegetables. I'll be honest, I tend to stick in the starchy. I'm not really good with the red and orange for sure. And my family is not sold on beans, so that makes it really hard to get that group as well. So ways to increase the variety of fruits and vegetables. We have lots of things that we can try. But the easiest thing that we found for people is just focusing on the colors. So what colors are you consuming? So plan meals to include different colored vegetables throughout the week. Again, if you are planning meals just kind of in your head and you're not really writing them down, that's going to be harder to make sure you have all the colors throughout the week. So writing things down is going to be a little bit easier. And making sure that the different colored vegetables will help with your picky eaters. So again, in my family, not all colors of vegetables are really welcomed. So trying to get those vegetables into different meals can be a struggle, but trying to incorporate them the best you can. Experiment with different vegetables when preparing healthy soups and salads. I would also include casseroles and stir fries in here too, just because soups, casseroles are a good way to hide vegetables where people may not know that they're in there. So those are little tricks if you have some picky eaters. The other thing that I think I mentioned before in a lunch and learn is if you're trying something new, make it the first thing that your family's trying. So if it's, and it's served with something that they will like. So if it's a new vegetable, let's say Brussels sprouts is usually one people aren't sold on, is that they try the Brussels sprouts right away in the meal and then continue with the rest of the meal after that. It just helps because then it's kind of out of the way, they tried it, and then you can move on to something that they like. The other thing related to that is remember it takes up to 15 times for someone to try something before they'll really be sold on if they like the taste of it. So to not give up. And then when vegetables are in season, make sure you're purchasing them. So we have wonderful farmers markets in Wood County. We have three for sure just in Wisconsin Rapids here. So to make sure that you're getting out and trying those and not just going for the egg rolls at the farmer's markets. Okay, the other one is focus on whole fruits. So whole fruits are really good as a snack. So bringing the banana, like someone said, is a good snack to have instead of the potato chips or the candy. Strawberries are going to be coming in season, so making sure we're tapping into that local source. But then also, again, you're going to see some of these fruits are going to be on sale in your grocery store coming up. So they're good ways to purchase them, spend the time prepping them, and then bring them to work as a snack. Trying recipes that use fruits such as salads or main dishes, and then enjoy fruit in place of sweets for dessert. So instead of the ice cream, having fruit instead, or maybe going with that parfait, because even with the yogurt and the granola, it's probably going to be less calories and less added sugar than ice cream. The other one related to this is home food preservation can help with fruits to help you get through the winter time or just basic freezing. But then the other thing for fruits is this is a good one to try new fruits that you've never tried before. So in our office, Jody Friday works with the pantry a lot. She was bringing in these different fruits that she was getting from Walmart that we've never heard of. And we were having to look a lot of them up online to figure out what they were and how to cut them and experiment with them, but our whole office was really invested in trying these different fruits. So again, trying different things, having it be the first thing that people eat at the table would be a good thing. I always tell young parents that when you're coming home and you're busy and you're trying to get food together and you're trying to do that meal preparation and kids are at your feet and they're wanting you to pay attention to them, tell them about their day, is fruit is a good place to start. Give them their fruit right away, have them eat it as you're prepping your meal, and then you sit down for your whole meal. It just kind of helps with that kind of juggling lots of things at one time. Okay, do you guys have any questions about those two groups first? So pretty easy. I think we all know we need to eat more fruits and vegetables. It's just how do we do it? So grains is your next group, making half of your grains whole grains. So just by a show of hands, how many of you do eat some whole grains? So brown, perfect. Okay, this is another group where some people are all in, like yes, all my grains that I'm eating are whole grains. Some people are half in, which means only certain things are whole grains in my house. And some people are really struggling with this group. So we have what we call refined grains, which is they're processed. So that would be like your white bread would be an example of that. So when we talk about grains, we have a grain kernel has three parts. So when they process something, those parts go away, which means the nutrition goes out of them. So that's where their color changes, and then we're missing the fiber content, we're missing some of the B vitamins from them because they've been processed. So like your cracker, some of your crackers, your white breads, your white pastas, those are all gonna be the refined ones. Your whole grain products are gonna have that whole grain kernel, which is gonna help with your nutrition. So it's gonna help with your fiber content, your B vitamins, and other nutrients that we want in there. And then these are the products that all do come in whole grain form. We're getting better as consumers and what was available to us in the grocery store related to whole grains. So obviously bread is a big one, crackers now, rice, and then pasta are all things you can find. So when we talk to people about whole grains, is some people get caught up with the lingo. Is we're gonna talk about food labels later on, but food labels can be misleading. They have those terms on there, low in fat, low in sugar, or this is whole grain, and sometimes it's really not. So you have to, on whole grain products, is actually look at the ingredients. Oops. And you are looking for anything, the word whole. So whole grain, whole wheat, and whole, and then whatever name it is, and then oats would be whole. So again, it contains all the nutrients. Words you may see is whole wheat or wheat flour. Semolina is one in pasta, white pasta, and durum wheat as well. Organic flour. Multigrain is the one that kind of trips people up. Is, well, it says multigrain. That means it's whole grain. Not necessarily. Okay? So there's still parts that are missing. And remember that it's a processed grain, which means they've removed parts of it and kind of hodgepodged it back together, which is why they call it multigrain. The other thing people get hung up on is color. Well, it's brown, so it's whole grain. Not always, okay? Color doesn't always mean that it's going to be whole grain. So you wanna look for those terms. So making half of your grains each and every day, excuse me, whole grains. So how do we do that? Is try preparing whole grains that's something that's new to you, so brown rice instead of white. All of you raised your hands though, so you're probably doing all of these. Switching to whole grain bread or tortilla wraps for sandwiches, and looking for cereals and snacks that use whole grain flours. Again, if you have, we have people that are struggling with the whole grain, is doing the half and half mixture. So half white pasta, half whole grain pasta, half white rice, half brown rice. And as you go on, just increase the amount of whole grain that you're using. So in my family, whole brown rice, easy sell. They were easy to convert. Whole grain pasta, no way. We're still trying to get them, or I'm trying to get them to switch over. The other thing with cereals is in the cereal aisle, remember that all the sugary goodness, added sugar ones are eye level for kiddos. All the ones that you should be eating whole grain are way up at the top. Okay, so just remember when you pick, look for the whole grain listed on the ingredients label. And cereals are really good about listing other nutrition on the label as well. So these are some things that you can try. So just looking at the screen really quickly, is there anybody who's had all of them? No? How about over half of them? So there's 8 of them total, so at least 4. Okay. Wheat is pretty easy. Most people, obviously, you have wheat. Kevon is something that kind of came on strong for a while. It's still hanging in there. Oats and corn is another one. Buckwheat, barley, bulgur, and then rye. So these are all whole grain products that you can try. And as we become, we're dealing with more food allergies, so people who want to be gluten-free or have to be gluten-free, and we're dealing with more of those things, some of these grains become more, you hear a little bit more about them for those reasons. Okay, on to the protein group. We want to vary your protein, mixing up your choices each and every day. So a lot of times people, overall, I would say most Americans are getting enough protein. You're getting enough protein in grains. You're lacking on fruits and vegetables. Just generally speaking, that's what we see. But what we want to encourage you to do for the protein group is mix it up. So you're not eating the same protein over and over again and sticking to the same animals. So varying your protein, making sure that you're including other things that maybe are new to your family. So we want to possibly substitute or up the amount of plant-based proteins that you're using. So the beans and the peas, so you're upping those just because they're full of B vitamins and they're full of fiber as well, along with protein. That's why they're listed in both groups. So I just did a program at the Marshfield Library, and we had just chickpeas that were used as a snack. So just taking a can of chickpeas, roasting them in your oven, sprinkling a little herbs and spices on them, and having them as a snack. Including also for people who are trying to lose weight or would like to lose weight, up your bean and your plant-based proteins because they're full of fiber, which means as soon as you eat them, your body fills up because fiber needs water to start to digest or work its way through your body, so you feel full. So that helps with people who are trying to lose weight because you end up eating less. So that's another reason why we encourage plant-based proteins or beans. The other one that I thought was kind of fitting for just the time of year we're heading into, and also for the lunch and learn that's for June, is the grilling or the baking fish in place of some other protein, and trying to put it in your diet 2 times a week. So here in Wisconsin, it's probably in there at least 1 time a week on Fridays, okay? It might be battered though, and served with french fries and some other things that you might want to fix, and I'm guilty of that too. But just upping your seafood, because it's full of omega-3s and omega-6s, which we know are good for heart disease and some of the, when we talk about the fats that we want you to have. So increasing your seafood content might be a good place to start, just trying different types of fish. Just remembering, though, that if you have little kiddos in your home or pregnant women, we have to be careful with some of the fish just because of mercury levels in them, just because their immune systems can't handle those doses. So salmon is another really popular one. I think that maybe is the one that's in the photo here today. But trying your fish baked on Fridays instead of fried, just making some of those small changes. But again, the grilling is coming into season, and that's also, just on a side note, a good method to cook your protein products in because it adds less fat to them. So. And then the last group that we're going to talk about today is their dairy group. So the low-fat and fat-free choices. So how many of you choose the low-fat options for your fluid milk? So it's skim or 1%. Okay, perfect. And then fat-free options for your other things. Now where the dairy group gets tricky is we often think about a grocery store, so everything that's in that refrigerated section is a dairy product. No. Okay, the only things that we count in the dairy product are the dairy group are your fluid milk, your cheese, and your yogurts. So your cream cheeses, your sour creams, all those other goodies, the creamers for your coffee, those are all wonderful, but in moderation, and those aren't considered a dairy group. So you need to think about that, yes, you put it in your body each and every day, but it doesn't count as your dairy serving. So you have to be careful with that. And just like all of your dairy products is we want low fat and fat free just because they really are high in saturated fat because they come from an animal. So we want to be careful how much we're consuming. So moving to those low fat options. So trying plain low fat yogurt with different fruits or whole grain cereals. So again, it's giving you that fruit group and incorporating those whole grains. And then making smoothies. So I don't know how many of you are sold on smoothies. They're good for people who really like them, and they're easy to keep the ingredients around because a lot of it you can freeze or the dairy products will stay for up to a week, if not longer. But if you have a family like me where we're not really sold on smoothies, that's really not one of our options to vary our dairy. So we have to think of other ways. Some other options would be to sprinkle low-fat or reduced cheese on top of soups, stews, and casseroles to add that little bit of dairy. And then enjoy a healthy snack of raw vegetables with dip or low-fat yogurt or cottage cheese. So again, I think most of us know that these are the better snacks we should be choosing, but the prep time is where we kind of get hung up, is, you know, prepping all of this stuff ahead of time. But these are all ways that you can incorporate or change your dairy. All right, just to kind of bring it all together, is what helps you eat healthy is the nutrition facts label. And on the left-hand side is what it looks like right now in the grocery store. And on the right is what it's going to look like in the future by 2018. So just really quickly at the two, comparing the two of them, is what do you see as one difference?
The serving size.
Okay, serving size is different. And then someone said calories. Yep, so if you look over here, the serving size, they flip-flopped them and they made them bigger. So they're a little bit easier to see. They've increased how big calories is.
Added sugar line.
Yep, they've added this added sugar line. Anything else? The other thing they...
Took out the vitamins.
Yep, I was just gonna say, they changed your vitamins. So over here it's A, C, calcium, and iron. Over here they switched it to D, calcium, iron, and potassium. So they took out A. And the reason why they're doing this is, just starting at the top, is just as we teach people how to use a nutrition label, this is where people get hung up, is, well, you know, I don't know how much I ate or what's the serving size. And to give you an example first, this one's pretty easy, 2/3 cup. You know, you can visually see that or measure it out. But there's other food products where it's really hard to know what they mean by their serving size. So I brought an example. It's not the best, most nutritious example, but the Ruffles potato chips. So Ruffles is one company that has made the switch. So if you buy Ruffles in the grocery store, they've switched to the new label. The other one that Wendy had was frosting, which we didn't think was a very good example either. So some companies are switching over. You're going to start to see the new labels. But related to that is, like, for chips, it was in ounces. Like, you can only eat like 28 grams. Well, what is 28 grams of chips? So now they've done a better job of telling you, well, it's 12 chips. So if you really want to count out 12 chips, you can. So they've tried to make it easier. And in my case, I should count out 12 because then I wouldn't eat the whole bag. The other thing is, like, a candy bar or a thing of soda or some things where you're going to eat the whole container of it, that's what they've put on the top. Instead of saying, like, so a candy bar is not a really good example, but if a candy bar, they would put 2 servings. Well, most people eat the whole candy bar or drink the whole thing of soda. So why tell them it's 2 servings? Just tell them if I drank or ate the whole thing, this is what I'm getting. So they changed that. And then the calories they've made nice and big, and they've taken out this calories from fat because no one really knew what it meant anyway. So other than those of us who are interested in it. So they've made the calories really big for you to see. They've added this added sugars just because we're always in trying to tell you to eat less processed food. So we're always trying to tell you to eat more whole foods, whole fruits, whole vegetables. So we're always trying to encourage you to do that. So we're trying to draw your attention to what is added into a product related to added sugars. So this is one way we're trying to do that. And also with sugars, is people got hung up, well, these numbers, they don't add up the same. So where is that other number going? So we've done a better job at making sure that those numbers seem a little bit more clear to you. Vitamin A, they found through studies, we're getting it. We're getting, because it's in carrots and that's a common vegetable for people, so we're getting enough vitamin A. We're getting enough vitamin C because we know that those are both important. We're lacking on vitamin D, though. And for your body cannot absorb calcium correctly without vitamin D. They work together. So vitamin D is one that they've put on now because we need to up that. And the other one is related to potassium. With sodium intake and blood pressure and heart disease and all those chronic diseases we have, potassium is very important. So we've put that on there to try to get people to eat more because through studies, we found out vitamin A you're getting enough of, but we found out you're lacking on potassium. So you're going to see this by 2018, has to be done. It has to be on every label moving forward. So ways to limit your added sugars, because that's something we're seeing on the label now, is enjoy fruit instead of dessert more often. So my little lady that says an apple over a chocolate cake, which is a hard one. Drink milk or water in place of a sugar-sweetened beverage. So if you're a soda drinker or a coffee drinker with lots of creamer in it, just limit how much that you're consuming and start substituting a whole 100% juice as well, along with your milk or your water. And then the other one is just choose foods and drinks with less added sugars by following that nutritious label. And again, I always tell people is you have to figure out why you're eating something. So if you, like me, I'm a big chip eater, well, what is it about chips that makes me want to eat them? What is it about soda that makes you want to have soda? What is it about candy? And try to find something that curbs that reason. So if it's the crunch, if it's the sugar, if it's the caffeine, what else can you have in place of it that maybe is going to be a little bit healthier for your diet? The other thing related to, besides the sugars, related to the choose my plate, is the sodium content. So we're all busy, we're all buying processed foods, which are gonna have a little bit more added sugar, and they're gonna have a little bit more added sodium. It's very hard to have a complete diet and menu plan without eating something that's processed, or comes in a package or a bag or a can. So again, paying attention to that nutrition facts label and comparing your different items in the grocery store, trying low sodium versions of foods, and then flavoring it with less salt and more herbs and spices. So herbs and spices can be found at the farmers markets coming up here. They're really easy to dehydrate on your own. They're relatively cheap, depending on which one in the store. So using more of those, excuse me, than just adding salt to everything. And also when you pick your canned vegetables, if that's one way you're having your family eat vegetables, is buy the low sodium content ones. Ways to limit saturated and trans fats. So saturated, remember, comes from an animal product, so your dairy products are really high in saturated fat. Your trans fats are from processed foods, so your cakes, your cookies, your chips, all those things. Frozen pizza would be another one. So choosing low-fat and fat-free dairy products, we've talked about that. Going lean on your protein foods, more plant-based. Including more plant-based oils in place of solid fats. So solid fat, butter, lard, would be your solid fats. Your plant-based oils would be more of your olive oils, your canola oils, those things. And then limit your sweet desserts and snacks. So again, trying to find, if you're a dessert eater, what's something you could have in place of it that's going to kind of give you that treat. And then like I said earlier on, is these are the nutrients we want you to have each and every day. So these are the things that are working in your body to make you function normally. Each and every day, and we get them through food. So carbohydrates, it's your energy source for your muscles and your tissues. Your protein is your building blocks for growth and maintenance. And your fat is your shock absorber and cushions your body organs, but also regulates your temperature. And all three of these will help with energy. So if you are not getting enough carbohydrates in your diet, your body will start to use protein and fat to help you be able to function each and every day. So these are your fuel, your big fuel ones for your car, which is your body. Your energy releasing, so these help with different body functions within your body and helping release those energy is water. So water is what's cleaning you out each and every day. So helps out flush the toxins, helps transport different vitamins and minerals throughout your body. And then different vitamins and minerals, there are way too many to get into today, but we've mentioned a few. So the more colorful you eat, the more likely you are to get these. If you eat very mono, so you eat the same thing every day, or eat very boring in colors, you're not going to get as many vitamins and minerals. It's going to be really hard for your body to get those. So putting it all together is we want you to be colorful. So the fruits, the vegetables, the whole grains, and the dairy. Using the nutrition facts label to make healthier choices and limiting those added sugars, sodium, saturated fat, and trans fat. So these two kind of link together. How you know about these is by reading this. So planning meals with a product from each of the five food groups whenever possible, which is easier said than done. So planning your meals is lack of planning goes back to old habits. So you're gonna have to work at it for a little bit and try to incorporate some new things. So you're gonna set a goal today Making a grocery store list and sticking to it. Don't shop hungry. That's another one. Avoid the middle aisles. And then remember to batch cook and have planned leftovers. We call them planned leftovers, not just leftovers, because we plan for that to happen. So if I buy a whole chicken and cook it up, it's going to be multiple meals for me and my family. It's not just going to be one. So I planned for it to be another meal product. I haven't just all of a sudden been like, oh yeah, well that's leftover. Okay, so really quickly, just because we're running out of time, is what food group is missing?
Dairy.
Very good. So that's an easy one, just having milk. And then we'll do one of these. So menu number one, you're eating a cup of oatmeal with a half a cup of milk, got whole wheat toast with peanut butter and coffee.
And egg for protein.
Okay, you can add egg for protein.
And some fruit.
Okay. And then you, hopefully in a perfect world, we could stick a vegetable in there too. So like raisins could go in your oatmeal, just a fruit on the side. Orange juice could be a juice. Someone said an egg. Those are all options that you could add. Okay, so putting it all together is you have a bright yellow sheet, which is like a prescription for healthy well-being. And kind of, like I said earlier in the time, it lists all the things that we need to be doing to be healthy people. You're welcome. And as we talk through these wellness topics that are happening each and every month, some of them are very nutrition focused, and then some of them are more other types of wellness focused. So we're working on you as a whole, not just you related to your diet. So looking at that prescription, if some of those are easier said than done, but on there, I want you to write one change that you can make related to this eating a variety and eating colorful. So out of all the things we talked about today, what's one thing that you think you could do related to your diet leaving here today? If you want to write it down really quick. And like I said, when you look at that, there's lots of other things on there related to being a healthy person. So the financial ones are in the middle, physical activity. And I heard someone say early on, like screen time is on there, which a lot of you probably stare at a screen all day. So that's going to be kind of a hard one for you. So maybe limiting screen time in other ways outside of your work day. But I would say we're really good in this building for sure is everybody's up and walking either outside or inside. So that's one that's easy to incorporate at work. But also having a buddy at work that you eat lunch with and keeping track of the colors that you're eating or how much you're eating of certain groups. Because anytime you can involve someone else in your goal setting, the more successful you'll be because they kind of hold you accountable. So that's related to that chief. Really quickly, just to kind of answer questions and then do evaluation at the same time, is the other goldenrod sheet you have. On the left-hand side, hopefully you marked what you're already doing related to the middle statements before you heard me talk today. And then on the right side is what you're willing to do as you leave the room today. So I'm willing to try this. I'm willing to maybe think about this as I move on. So if you would spend some time filling that out. And then just for you guys to know is next month, our Lunch and Learn is on Wednesday, May 10th, and it's about environmental health. So Kate Carlson and Greg Kolaji, I hope I said it right, is going to be here talking about environmental health. So look for that one. So you can leave the surveys on the table. Anything you filled out for me, there's lots of resources to grab. If you have questions, great. Otherwise, we're right at time, so thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Enjoy the spring weather that's hopefully going to happen.
Let's hope.